You're listening to the audio production of Seven Desires, Looking Past What Separates Us to Learn What Connects Us, by Mark and Debbie Laaser, published by Zondervan and read by Ruth and Max Bloomquist.
To our children, Sarah, Jonathan, and Benjamin, who God has given us and entrusted us with the opportunity to serve the seven desires of their hearts. Acknowledgements. Every book has a journey. Some books start with the wounds of their authors and the healing journey they have discovered. Such is the case with this book. This book's journey began in 1987, when we were a very broken couple. We were referred to a therapy center in a simple and unpretentious place. We had driven past this modest building many times, but had never noticed the small sign, New Hope, nor had we ever thought about needing some of that for ourselves. We had no idea we were going to meet two of the finest therapists we've ever known. Tom and Maureen Graves began serving us in ways that left us wanting more. Yearnings of our hearts were being met in that modest place, and we were growing emotionally and spiritually. Over the years of working with Tom and Maureen, and of finding hope for ourselves, the ideas that formed the basis for this book developed. Tom and Maureen were students of one of the greatest therapists and teachers of the 20th century, Virginia Satir. Even though we never met Virginia, through Tom and Maureen, we feel as though we know her. We owe a great debt of gratitude to her work. It was her model in those early days that showed us that our problems were only symptoms of deeper desires. As we discovered our own desires, the model of the seven desires began to take shape. At first, we took what we were learning home to our own family. As parents of three precious children, Sarah, John, and Ben, we began to see that underneath their problems were also deeper, unexpressed emotions and desires. In our own imperfect parenting, we tried to serve their desires. We are grateful to them for their patience with us as parents. We are so proud of the young adults they are today. We are also extremely gratified to see how sensitive they are to the desires of others. In the ongoing journey of this book, God has continued to bring us many hurting people. In every case, they would come to us with a behavior that was creating crisis in their lives. We are thankful to those that trusted us long enough to help them discover the deeper desires of their hearts underneath these behaviors. We know that it takes a commitment not to look for a quick fix. It also takes a willingness to do the hard work of lasting change. We wish we could name all of them. Their stories are what we hope make this book more relevant to the reader. They are the ones who helped us finally name the seven desires.
Over the years, a number of churches have invited us to present the material in this book. We thank every one of them for giving us the opportunity to test our ideas. We also thank them for their encouragement and prayers. We especially thank Dave Troutman at Westwood Church in Minnesota for all of the time he spent helping us incorporate the Seven Desires material into the couples ministry of that church. Through some work we did with the International Bible Society, we met a man who is himself a writer and editor. Pat Springle graciously volunteered his time to review the manuscript and made invaluable suggestions. Every book's journey has those who have encouraged it in a variety of ways. Jennifer Sisney was one of the first to tell us that this material was worth developing. Gary Gray and his staff at Gray Communications helped us in some of the early formulation of our teaching. Bob and Jonna Hale of Life Ministries have been enthusiastic about this material since we first began talking about it. Mary Munger interpreted the stances with her professional artwork. Mike and Linda Richards, Elizabeth Griffin, and Dave Carter have all in their own way supported us. Finally, the journey of this book has been prayerfully encouraged and supported by the entire Zondervan family. For the last 15 years, we have been blessed to know our editor, Sandy Vanderzeit. This is the third book of ours she has graciously shepherded through completion. Thanks, Sandy, for affirming us, choosing us, and including us in your work. Mark and Debbie Laaser, Eden Prairie, Minnesota, September 2008.
Introduction. Our lives are shaped by the things we desire. Thomas Merton. We believe that God created us with 7 basic universal desires. Each of us desires to be heard and understood, to be affirmed, to be blessed, to be safe, to be touched, to be chosen, and to be included. Having and fulfilling these desires validates our very existence. If these basic desires are fulfilled, we will enjoy a deeper and richer relationship with God and with others. God put the 7 desires deep inside our souls for good reasons. When we understand our desires and realize that they are the same for everyone, we can live in deeper and more meaningful community. Finding our commonalities draws us toward one another. Giving and receiving these desires allows us to connect with each other in truly intimate ways. Understanding our desires also helps us discover our true need for God. He is the only one who can truly satisfy our desires at the deepest level of our soul. But there is a problem with our 7 desires. They are so deep in our souls, we don't always consciously understand that they are there. We feel them in our hearts, and we ache for them to be fulfilled, but we don't know the source of that ache. Instead of accepting the fact that we have pain and loneliness because our desires are unfulfilled, we lead lives of quiet loneliness and frustration, lives laced with anger and bitterness. We hurt and we long for something more, but we often don't even know what that something more is. Often we look to our relationships to fill us up. It is not wrong, of course, to expect fulfillment and happiness from our closest relationships, but we run into trouble when we ask those relationships to do too much. In this book, we want to suggest first that God is both the creator of and the ultimate fulfillment of these 7 desires. Second, only when we look to God first to fulfill our desires can we then also find our desires met by other people. When we look first to friends and family to fulfill our desires, we are setting ourselves up for disappointment. But offering our desires first to God frees us to also have our desires met by other people, and to meet their desires too. Before we go further, let us tell you a little bit about ourselves. We have been married for 35 years, having originally met in high school. Mark was trained as a pastor and counselor. He worked in his field for 15 years until he was intervened on for sexual addiction and went to inpatient treatment. When Mark returned home from treatment, we both committed to counseling for ourselves individually as well as for our marriage. We were referred to a local therapist, Maureen Graves, who had been trained personally by Virginia Satir. Satir has been considered by many to have been one of the greatest family therapists of all time. Mark remembers his first session with Maureen. He was frightened and ashamed that Maureen would judge him for his moral failures. After telling her his story, she said to him, "Mark, to do all of those things, you must have been in a lot of pain." Maureen had already begun to use Satir's model with Mark. For Satir, the problem is never about behaviors. It is always about deeper issues that create that behavior.
Over the years, as we have worked with Maureen, we feel extremely blessed that she was our therapist. Through her, we felt like we got to know Virginia Satir, even though we never had the privilege to meet her. The ideas of this book are based in large part on the foundation of Virginia's work as we have sought to incorporate it in our own lives. Today, as we work with hundreds of other people, we have continued to develop it in light of our own Christian faith. We created Faithful and True Ministries 20 years ago so that through our counseling, teaching, and writing, we might help other people find spiritual and emotional growth. This book is, in some ways, a debt of gratitude to the work of Virginia. Through Maureen, she taught us to understand our own desires. Here, we hope to help you do the same. In this book, we want to teach you several things. First, we want to help people understand the 7 desires, the desires to be heard and understood, to be affirmed, to be blessed, to be safe, to be touched, to be chosen, and to be included. And we want especially to make clear that they are common to both men and women. Second, we want to help people see how childhood and adult life experiences teach them about their desires and about getting them met. If you did not have the desires met in your childhood, you may find unhealthy ways to get them met as an adult. We will show how this happens and what it looks like when it does. Third, we want to help you reclaim the truth about yourself and your desires. God made you as a unique and wonderful treasure. God loves you and intends for your desires to be fulfilled. God Himself is the source of that fulfillment, yet He often works through other healthy people to provide your desires. Fourth, we want to teach you how to help other people have their desires met. This is a form of service. We are called to serve, and when we do, we will also be served. At the end of each chapter, we offer some points to ponder. These are suggestions about how to think about the information you've just gained. But you don't have to do them in order to understand the book. However, pondering these points will help you digest the information and make it more personally applicable to you. God loves you, and He calls you into relationship with Him. He has put the seven desires in your heart to show you how to have that relationship. As Psalm 37:4 puts it, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart." When you know this, you can find healthy ways to get your desires met, and you can serve the desires of others. As with any of our books, speeches, or counseling, our constant prayer is that our words be instruments of God's truth. May that be so as you continue on.
Chapter 1, The Seven Desires. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Psalm 37:4. What are the seven desires? In this chapter, we will describe each of them. But first, remember that the seven desires are universal. All of us have all of them. Whatever your age, gender, culture, or religious background, your desires are the same as everyone else's. As you go through this chapter, try to think about times in your life when you felt your desires were being fulfilled and times when they weren't. Ultimate fulfillment in life is the result of having these desires met, as well as having the opportunity to serve the desires of others.
The first desire, to be heard and understood. Think back for a minute to a time when you felt someone was truly listening to you. Maybe it was your mother, listening to you when you were 7 as you described being teased on the playground. Maybe it was your new girlfriend hanging in rapt attention as you talked about your family. Maybe it was your best friend listening as you shared your fears about having a baby. Whoever it was, didn't you feel that he or she truly cared about you? We have so many things to say. We are born to communicate. And yet so often we feel that we are not being truly heard. You know the feeling. You're trying for the umpteenth time to tell your husband about some frustration or need or desire, and he just doesn't seem to be listening. He just doesn't get it. For many of us, our assumptions about being heard or being ignored are rooted in childhood. Think back to kindergarten or fifth grade or your junior year of high school. What was your experience of being heard? Or of not being heard? Your parents may have been the greatest and most loving people, yet perhaps they were often stressed or busy and didn't seem to have time to listen. Did you hear words like, "later," or "don't bother me"? Maybe you heard, "that's a stupid thing to think," or "it's not Christian to talk like that." Many children have adults in their lives who talk to them, give advice, admonish them, teach them, but they don't have adults that want to listen to their feelings, needs, struggles, or opinions. If you had a childhood in which people talked to you, or worse, at you, but never really listened, you may have given up on talking. Now, as an adult, you find that you can talk about superficial matters, but you may be unpracticed at talking about what is really going on inside of you. When your sibling or spouse says, "You never talk to me," you have no clue what they mean. You have no practice in talking, much less in being heard. Yet we all desire to be heard. Sometimes our desire to be heard literally causes us to speak differently. When we want to communicate something important and feel we are not being heard, we might raise our voice, thinking that if we talk louder, maybe we will finally be heard. Often, people who yell and scream are really people who are desperate to be heard. Alternately, if we want to be heard, sometimes we might say something more slowly. We might assume that the person we're talking to is just too dumb to get it, so we repeat ourselves. Slowly. We say things like, "Let me spell it out for you." And sometimes, when we don't feel heard, we talk quickly. We've got a whole lot to say, and we need to get it in. We hate to give up control of the conversation, and we never finish a sentence, stringing together phrase after phrase with "but" and "ah, you know, so." We often don't want to give up control of the floor until we feel we have been heard. Then there are those who simply repeat what we're saying over and over and over. When we do this, we talk a lot. One of our friends often says, "He likes to talk a whole lot more than I like to listen." At times, we can also get overly rational and argumentative. We say things like "you always" and "you never," and then cite examples and every historical evidence of why we're right. We call this case building, because we are building our case to prove our point. Since we want to be heard and understood, we feel that we need to justify what we are saying. The problem with case building is that it forces whoever we're talking to into defending their case or interpretation. In the face of our lawyer-like arguing, they either shut down, or they too build a case using examples and justifications. The result? We get an argument, usually a very reasonable one, in which no one is really listening to the other. Both sides come out frustrated and not feeling like they've been heard or understood. Sometimes in our efforts to be heard, we regress, resorting to strategies that we learned early in our lives. What do children do when they want to be heard? They don't have the ability to reason yet. They may not even have language skills. So they cry or scream, plead, stomp, hit, pound, bargain, or use any other dramatic behavior to get attention. Believe us, we've worked with couples who act like 3 or 4 year old children. Adults are capable of having tantrums just like children. Those tantrums are simply attempts to be heard and understood. The problem is, of course, that tantrums don't work. Instead, they alienate others who wind up simply wanting to get away from this immature behavior. How can we be heard by others? Ironically, one of the first steps in being heard is to listen. In order for us to connect, we must first be willing to listen. Over the years, we have been to numerous seminars about how to be better communicators, which, when simplified, really means being better listeners. We have been taught to be active listeners, to not interrupt, and to repeat back what we heard so that we can be sure we got it right. We've been taught to mirror each other, to look into each other's eyes, and to truly know each other. Sometimes the people we care about the most are often the ones who seem to have the hardest time hearing us. Conversely, sometimes we have a difficult time listening to those we love the most. When we are invested in a relationship, our own emotions often distract us from truly listening, even if we have the best of intentions of doing so. Great listening skills get trumped by our desire to be heard ourselves. And so we interrupt or interject our own opinion or figure out a way to get the focus back to our feeling, need, or opinion. It is a difficult cycle to change, for we all selfishly need to be heard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.